Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago, Barbados, Toronto, Atlanta, GA, Philadelphia, PA. Everybody get on board the night train.
It's Friday afternoon in the big city here in Toronto. 11 degrees outside. Right here with Bill and Jess King for Groove Radio Friday. So welcome in.
Yeah.
Jess.
Man, I dig it.
I really enjoyed that.
That was fun.
Yeah.
Nice to have
you. Version excursion, right?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, when I started doing this show back in 2013, I had the Thursday night 10 to 12, and I had a good friend, Prince Blanco, Mark Matthews, who used to be the co-host. And Saucily, Mark, and Aram and I go back like 12 years, so it's nice to have him back on the air with us.
And play some nice tunes.
Yeah, and music guys.
You know something that was killing me, though, was the commercial in between for Ron Korb. Man, I'm going to send you downtown to, like, you know, I'm going to send you over to CHFI or something.
You know, it's funny because we did that last week.
You did that.
We had to run
that
out.
That was so quick. I don't know how you did that.
Two passes.
You put some smooth on it.
Yeah, but, you know, I got to give full credit to Miku. He edited it. He made it sound good.
He did. It was a great job there, Jesse.
Thanks, Bob.
Boy, I can't believe Suge Knight got 28 years.
You know, when we were talking about this in the car, you know what my feeling was?
What?
That wasn't enough.
He really did a job on a lot of rappers, didn't he?
Well, yeah.
Boy, he put the vice on you.
You saw the movie grips. Compton, right?
Yeah.
And that one scene where it's the studio out, the hang space outside, it's just full of thugs.
Yeah.
You know, and Dr. Dre's coming in. He just wants to do music, work on his tunes, but all these people are just like living off him. And then basically walks into Suge Knight's and says, I want out. And Suge said, the only way you're getting out is basically you give me absolutely everything. I own all your material. And he went, okay.
That sounds like a great deal at the moment.
You know what? I think it was a very good deal for Dre.
You know, you could just find body parts. You know, you're spread all over the nation. Suge have you dropped off in areas. You know?
So what you been up to? What's going on?
You know
what?
A couple things here just thinking about. We're going to talk about some books. We want to also talk about Jeff Emmerich. And I think we talk about him later.
Okay. Yeah, save that one.
In the news, because I have a whole lot of stuff from people who have commented on him. Some great stuff, you know. And Jeff, of course, was the Beatles engineer.
That's right.
So we'll get to that later. A couple things. You know, I love film and TV shows and stuff. One of them is came in on Friday night, last Friday was Chef's Table. I absolutely love Chef's Table. It's not like your typical cooking show, right? And this is so off the wall for what the show's about. But if you enjoy stories about people with a passion for an art and go in there and they go madly insane over what they're doing, then you will enjoy Chef's Tables, because these are some of the greatest chefs and eccentrics in the world, right? And there's only 5 episodes and they're about 50 minutes. But you can be in the Philippines with a great Philippines chef. But going back to the roots, the people who go back to how food was originally prepared.
Okay.
And it's their life, how they go about finding the produce. Some of them have organic farms, how they go out of the way to do this, how they search for new ideas, how they never sleep, and they're always experimenting.
Interesting, yeah.
It's just
their passion.
Yeah, and you're there with people, and you get emotionally involved in them. it's so different, and the cinematography is out of this world.
You know, on the topic of chefs, this was out last week, I think I saw it on TV. There's talk, basically, there's this kind of new trend where some of these top chefs don't want to get a Michelin star anymore. And you know, for those who don't know, a Michelin star is like you get a Michelin star and you're basically set for life as a chef, because you can work anywhere. You get 2 stars, it's over. They don't want the pressure.
And you have to keep that up.
And that's the thing. So a lot of them are opting for just, I'm good. You know?
Yeah, just let me make what I make. Yeah. You know, and some, you know, and it's interesting because you'll see the people go to all these lengths to create these exotic dishes. But when they go out and eat on their own, they'll eat at some neighborhood place where somebody fries fish just great.
Mm-hmm.
And they're totally content.
Yeah.
So it's great stuff.
I remember watching Anthony Bourdain. He would stop at like truck stops, you know, like the food trucks.
And just say, have,
let me taste that sauce there.
And that's the key to it, too. Yeah. Some people just have these things. The second part is A Star is Born.
The Gaga.
Yeah, I've just been reading everything on this.
And so what's the verdict so far?
It's just overwhelmingly people just think this is a great film.
Okay.
And it's basically the chemistry between Lady Gaga and Bradley Cooper. And this is Bradley Cooper's film debut as a director, right? And how they put the story together and avoided all the hokey stuff of the originals, right? The other two that were out with Streisand and then one with Julie Garland before that. How they've taken this story just down to the made it an earthy story, mm-hmm. you know, between a young woman who wants to sing and be part of this world of music, who has all the drive, which is Lady Gaga, period, right? Mm-hmm. And a down and out guy who's just, you know, trying to keep his life together, battling addictions and everything. But the chemistry between the two, and she says, the moment that she heard Bradley Cooper open his mouth and start singing, she was blown away. She just said, this guy can sing. I think for her, this is a major step, and I will actually pay for this.
Okay.
I will go see this.
She did the American Horror Story franchise a couple years ago, and she was actually quite good.
Yeah.
You know, she made the show, and she held her own. And so, you know, it's interesting because I think she has the chops to kind of branch out into this movie, obviously, and film, because the music career, she's kind of been – the top pop star.
Everywhere.
She's done the jazz.
Yeah.
She loves music. I think she's just a creative person that just has a lot of outlets.
Well, it kind of reminds me where Cher was at in her music and then Moonstruck.
Right.
And she's
so good in that.
She
did
a great job there, Nicolas Cage, right?
Yeah.
And this is her. Anyway, some music?
Musica.
Okay, this is all what right. we're about. Jess, I was digging into this James Brown album, Motherlode. This is one that's been overlooked,
what
right?
What year is this, Motherlode?
This is actually a collection of instrumentals and outtakes and everything from 67 to 73. And they put it together as kind of this thing called Jungle Music or Jungle Groove when they released it. And they released the album, the compilation, in 1988. And this is an old Hank Ballard tune and James Brown wrote together with Maceo Parker on sax, and it's called She's the One.
Everybody, body wants to know why I love her so. Listen to me, please. And I will tell you why. And I feel this way until the day I die. Because deep, all right now, listen to me now.
James Brown, She's the One, from 1973. Oh, man, is that a great bass line and guitar line?
It's
that makes that track.
It's just militant groove.
It's militant
groove. And I tell you, at two-minute mark, I felt like the song had been on for 4 minutes. It's that good.
It was.
Full.
Just sweet, James. Yeah. Let's keep that kind of vibe going with Fatback Band, and this is from 1975.
Oh, like a Wiki Wacky.
Wiki Wacky, man. This was a hit in 75 for
the album. I'm just waiting. Hustle.
Hustle.
The ultimate Fatback.
We're in the 70s.
Yeah. Come on. I'm looking for the party people. The party people who love to get down. I'm looking for the party people. Party people. Party people, where's the party?
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, man.
That rim shot, man, it's dry. There ain't not a stitch of reverb on that. Pop, pop, pop.
You know, it's when you send out the red alert there, where's the party? Party people. Jesse, how about some Diplomats of Soul?
Yeah, man.
Now, this is a band from Iowa City, Iowa, and this is a song called Trouble Me. You're right here with Bill and Jess King on Groove Radio Fridays.
You got me crying. You got me waiting. Trouble me. You got me watching. Trouble me. For you to come down my road. Trouble me. I should know. Trouble that it was time.
Diplomats of Soul trouble me. Man, that reminds me so much of Ray Charles' Unchain My Heart.
Yeah.
Unchain My Heart.
Especially that groove, too.
Yeah, the groove and everything.
Yeah.
Jesse, you like the black? You like Blackstreet?
I do.
You know this track?
I know it's a classic.
1966, Teddy Riley and Chauncey Hannibal.
It was the original.
The original, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I think this was
This was 90s.
Yeah, 1996 is when it came out.
But
and, yeah, they're,
should we just play it?
Yeah, well, they're the brains behind this, but it's kind of a great track.
It is.
All right.
It's Dr. Dre in there, too.
CIUT 89.5.
Yeah. You know what? I like the players. No diggity, no doubt. Play on, play it. Play on, play it. Yo, Dre, drop the verse. It's going down, fade to Blackstreet. The homies got at me, collab creations. Bump like agony, no doubt. I put it down, never slouch. As long as my credit can vouch, a dog couldn't catch me. Say now, tell me who could stop with Dre making moves, attracting honeys like a magnet, giving them orgasms with my mellow accent. Still moving this flavor with the homies Blackstreet and Teddy, the original rough shakers.
Shutting it down, good lord. Baby got them open all over town. Strictly bitch, you don't play around. Cover much grounds, got game by the pound. Getting paid is a forte. Each and every day, true play away. I can't get her out of my mind.
Wow.
I think about the girl all the time.
Wow.
East side to the west side. Pushing fat rides, it's no surprise. She got tricks in the stash. Stacking up the cash. Fast when it comes to the gas. By no means average. It's on when she's got to have it. Baby, you're a perfect 10. I wanna get in. Can I get down so I can? I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up, girl.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
She's got class and style. She knowledge by the pound. Baby never act wild. Very low key on the profile. Catching feelings is a no. Let me tell you how it goes. Herbs the word, spins the verb. Lovers it curves so freak what you heard. Rolling with the fatness. You don't even know what the half is. You got to pay to play. Just for shorty bang bang to look your way. I like the way you work it. Trump tight all day, every day. You're blowing my mind, maybe in time. Baby, I can get you in my ride.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Oh,
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
I got to bag it up.
Bag it up, babe.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity.
Don't dig it.
First class from New York City to Black Street. What you know about me? Now don't off the thing. Cartier wooded frame sported by my shorty. As for me, icy gleaming pinky diamond ring. We bees to buy this click up on this scene. Ain't you getting bored with these fake boards? How shows improves, no doubt. I've been thinking so. Please excuse if I come across rude. That's just me. And that's how a player's got to be. Stay kicking game with a capital G. Ask the peoples on my block. I'm as real as can be. Word is on. Faking moves never been my thing. So Teddy, pass the word to your nigga Chauncey. I'll be sending a call, let's say around 3:30. Queen Pen
no
and Black.
No diggity, no doubt, baby.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity,
I got the bag.
Girl,
it
up. I got it going on.
I like the way you work it.
No diggity,
no
diggity.
I got the bag.
Come on. That's a snare, eh? I remember years ago you said to me when I gave you a mix, you said, you got to make the snare pop.
That's right.
And I've never forgotten that. Anytime I listen to certain songs, I'm listening for, is that snare popping? And that snare is popping.
You know, something that's, it's the strangest thing to, when, as many years as I've been in the studios, I mean, I could say over the years they would do a mix and you'd be leaving there and it'd be just wishy-washy. Mm-hmm. And then underneath you hear the drums playing a nice steady pattern. And I'd always argue with people and say, you know, bring the drums up. If you listen to Rolling Stones and you listen to their music from the 70s, like Exile Main Street, Charlie Watts sits on top.
Yeah.
Right? In that mix, that snare drum, the kick drum, you know, for people who are inexperienced, they're going to the studio, well, this is there, and it all sounds great, but you forget there's these hidden secrets that you have to do. Same way with Rich Hall down in,
Rick Hall, yeah.
Hall talking about the bass, right? Mm-hmm. He's there mixing Aretha's records and everything, and he keeps pumping the bass. And
giving that sound.
I mean, now everybody's got it together. I mean, young people have great ears, and they seem to be on top of this now because they can play with the drums separately.
And they have the tools for it.
They have the tools.
It's not like the old days.
No, Jess, this is a cool tune now. I found this last night just searching around for something to play today, right?
Yeah.
So I dropped back to 1969, and this guy, Al Escobar. And he's originally from Colombia, and then he moved to California and then worked his way to New York City and became Eartha Kitt's music director. And it's all this Afro-Cuban style music. So he had a few hits, semi-hits in the 60s, and this is one of them called Ape Walk.
I like the name already.
Bill and Jess King, Groove Radio Fridays here at CIUT 89.5. Oh, yeah. Al Escobar.
Cool tune.
It's Orchestra 1969.
Really good.
Wasn't that great?
It sounds like it's out of the 50s almost, too.
Yeah, it's got that whole sound. So, news time. What you got?
Well, actually, I don't know if this is true. I just came across this
as
we started that Trump exited Air Force One with toilet paper, or he boarded with toilet paper hanging off his shoe. There's, like, video of this.
When was this?
I don't know. Let me see here.
Is this like a year ago, or did you just?
I just saw this, man. Let me just check in here, because
check in, man,
because
this
this made me laugh, because
it could be April of 2017.
The comments were
what?
You know, Trump has no friends. Nobody was willing to tell him, dude.
Get this off your.
You
shirt.
Have toilet paper hanging off your stuck to his shoe.
You work on that, okay?
Yeah, this is Thursday. This was Thursday.
Thursday,
so yesterday.
Okay. Oh, yesterday, really?
That's really funny.
I wonder where he was.
Yeah. Nobody, all of his Secret Service, not one person.
Well,
said,
nobody wants to talk to him.
Nobody.
What are you going to say to this guy?
Excuse me, sir. He goes, I meant to do that.
I meant to.
The greatest piece of toilet paper ever.
You know, he did it on purpose. Jess, yep. So Billy McFarland, who was the head of Fry Festival, the co-owner?
Yeah, yeah, right.
Oh, you love this. He may very well be on his way to prison for like till 2033.
Now, what's the deal with
the
this?
The deal was, you know, yeah. The Fry Festival. These guys had founded a credit card company called Magnesis, right? And it was dubbed the Black Card Millennials, right? And so McFarland and Magolian, Grant Magolian, the company's chief marketing officer, and Daniel Simon, an indie contractor, collectively misled investors to dump money into this and lost a fortune, right? So he starts this festival, sells the world on this just high-end festival in the Bahamas, right, on the great Exuma Island. And people get there, and it's just like tent city. They're supposed to have these, you know, just
luxury
accommodations, the best food ever eaten, and security. And it was a bust, and he ripped everybody off, right? And so they nailed him, and he's being prosecuted.
Well, I saw that he mentioned, you know, he had mental stress. That was one of his possible arguments.
That will do it. What's up?
You know, new books this week. You'd sent a link to me, and I actually saw that Bob Lefsetz said mentioned it, and so of course I ran out and got it. Anything for a Hit, an A&R Woman Story of Surviving the Music Industry by Dorothy Carvello. She began at Atlantic Records in 85, something like that, as Ahmet Erdogan's secretary, and kind of rose through the ranks very, very painfully and very slowly. And it's really just a perspective from a woman's point of view of what it is like, and I'm sure it still exists to a degree, but how horrible it was to be a woman in the music business and trying to make it, even if you achieve the same level as an executive, is still the guy who is going to get double the pay and all the good stuff while you could have been thrown away at any time. So fascinating look at inner workings of Atlantic. She also worked at Columbia, had dealings with Irving Azoff, and all these people were really not nice to her at all.
No, it, very interesting, too, because there was this thing that you answer the phones, you do the bookkeeping, you look after artists as they come and go, you try to make them happy, and then you go for coffee.
And this was it, you know,
you
even
just do these
after she left Atlantic. Yeah. And years later, she always kept in touch with Ahmet. She said it was basically like, he was kind of like a mentor, but he was treated her horrible at some times. You know, so and you know, he was all very old school, where he was just basically inappropriately touching everybody all the time. Yeah. And the stories of him, his nightly out, like his bouts of drinking and cocaine and staying up all night, and then basically at the end of the night falling flat on his face, and she'd have to carry him home.
Right.
You know, this
She's
was
done this extra. This is during the Just Me movement.
Yeah, this was original. So interesting book. So that's one. I think it's worth a read. Great story of it, though.
Yeah. How many books do we ever see from women who write about their experiences behind the scene with these?
I think we're going to see more
these
now.
These moguls.
I think we're starting going to see more, and I think it's a great idea because it totally different
talk.
Perspective. Yeah. Great Tommy Mottola,
okay,
who used to run, I think, Sony Music, and he signed and married Mariah Carey.
That's right.
Well, of course, he pimped her out everywhere in the sense that he got her on all the shows, got her all the best things, really spent a lot of money about her, back her. Gets to the point where, you know, she gets nominated for 6 Grammys in like 96, doesn't win a thing. She comes to me and goes, what are you good for if you can't get me a Grammy? So he basically, he sends a letter to Mike Green, who was head of NARIS.
That's right.
And says, you need to change the voting because my wife didn't win. Right. Mike just says, this ain't going to happen, man.
No.
But she splits from him, and this bitter feud ensues. She's starting to film the movie Glitter. And Glitter was a massive tank of a movie,
right?
Which is basically a movie about her. But there's these songs. Tommy hears songs in it before it goes to production and basically steals them out from under, gives them to J-Lo. She has two massive hits, and Mariah can't do anything about it. Now she got no hits from the album and a bad movie. So,
and then there was the, I think it was the Grammy, and she didn't win. She gave the whole audience stink eye.
Yeah.
She was like,
she's Mariah.
It just turned to this thing. Yeah. Jess, we wanted to get to this. This is Jeff Emerick passed away.
Oh, yeah. Right?
And he was the Beatles engineer. 72 years old. And here's, I don't know if you know this, but check this out. While, this is William Zabaleta, right? His friend. He was Emerick's manager, right? While on the telephone with Jeff, he knew he had complications and dropped the phone. At that point, I called 911, but by the time they got there, it was too late. So Jeff suffered from a heart attack problems for a long time, and he had a pacemaker.
Wow.
And you know, when it's your time to go. We lost a legend. So the career, starting at EMI at 15 years old, teenage engineer, found himself with the Beatles for the first sessions in 1962. And then he kind of said he was at the right place at the right time, and he worked on Revolver, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, and the White Album.
Yeah, that's it. He has a book. The book, I highly recommend. It's a fascinating read and well-written. It takes you from start to finish through his career and working with the Beatles. It's the inner workings of how they interacted with each other, how they recorded, all that kind of inside information that's always fascinating for us on
and
the outside.
And it's called Here, There, Everywhere.
Yeah.
And here's what he says. He said, Paul might say this song needs brass and timpani. John's direction might be more like give me the feel of James Dean gunning his motorcycle down a highway. Or make me sound like the Dalai Lama chanting on a mountaintop.
Yeah, that was it.
Two contrasting ways of trying to get the same thing across.
John would just say, I want to sound like I'm underwater. So they would stick a microphone in glass and have him spin around. They'd try anything. That was the fascinating thing at the time. Great story. It talks about Yoko Ono and how she just ended up in the studio. But the Beatles, being British, would not say anything.
They didn't say anything at all, did they?
John and Yoko have a car accident, and they come in. They convalesce, you know, as they're healing in the studio. She has a bed brought into the studio.
Right in the studio, yeah.
She cut a curtain around it, and she's having visitors where they're trying to record an album. But none of them say anything.
Nope.
But you know what really almost put the band over edge, especially George Harrison? He always kept a thing of biscuits on top of his amp. She walked over one day and took a biscuit.
Oh, no, you never do that.
He was about to lose it, man.
You remember when you lost that whole pack of biscuits in rehearsal?
You can't, man.
You can't.
I thought that was a box of raisins.
Paul McCartney had this to say. He said, I first met Jeff when he was a younger engineer working at Abbey Road Studios. He would grow to be the main engineer that we work with on many of the Beatles tracks. He had a sense of humor that fitted well with our attitude to work in the studio and was always open to the many ideas we threw at him. Jeff would use a special microphone for the bass drum and play it strategically to achieve the sound that we were asked for. He would spend many exciting hours in the studio and never failed to come up with the goods. And he came with me to Lagos to record Band on the Run. I remember arriving at the Hall-built studio with a handful of 45s, which I played for him, to explain the direction that I wanted to take this album in. And I remember asking him to make sure the tracks had a lot of space, and he was happy to deliver that. We kept in touch through the years, and our phone calls and the messages always gained a giggle or two.
Amazing guy. It was working with the Beatles and him being young that changed the sound and the way sound was recorded, because at EMI at the time, there was brown shirts and white lab coat guys.
Yes, and that's but they that's how they were at Abbey Road, weren't they? They were like lab men, right?
And so there was this, everything was set up for every session the same way. The drums always went in the same spot, same mics, everything. And you couldn't, don't touch a mic. You actually had to have the guy in the white coat coming down do it.
Yeah.
Beatles got so popular that they could do that. And that's when Jeff started experimenting on different mics, miking positions, moving the drums. And that just changed the entire spectrum of what the sonic possibilities were and what you could do with a studio as part of your instrumentation. So hats off to Jeff and, of course, the Beatles.
Jesse, you know, musicians on the road almost certainly these days means they can't live healthily, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's some pro tips for this, and you may know them. Number one, stay hydrated.
Yep.
Work out. You got to figure a way to work it. You've got to.
You know, I started doing that.
I saw your what was that band you were on the road with? You killed me, man. You were sending me text messages. That English band, English Beat.
The English Beat, yeah.
And, you know, you send me a text. You say I'm up in the back window in a bunk, and these guys are going losing it.
It was the condo. I had the condo bunk. That's what
they
called them.
You had the condo bunk traveling across America.
Space. There's the coffin bunk and then there's the condo bunk. You want the condo bunk.
You know what it was? It was a call for help.
Yeah.
I don't know how you survived that one.
And you know what? These guys, I give them massive, props for their durability. I spent only a month on that thing, and that was way enough for me.
Pack healthy snacks, stretch, see a chiropractor, take a multivitamin. Take days off when you're sick. See a doctor, which is always good, you know. That's the one that goes in the back of your head, maybe.
See a doctor?
But maybe I should, or maybe not. It says take care of your sexual health. I can imagine what that's like on the road.
I don't want to go into that one.
Don't end up pregnant. Mind your mental health and take care of your body on the road. I think that all makes sense.
Yeah. Well, you could tell the seasoned veterans when I was on the road with these guys versus the younger lads, because the seasoned guys actually had fruit and would have like water and stuff.
You know what I did, though? I was insane. I packed a basketball, so I played basketball every day.
That's a great idea.
Got into soccer. I would try to get the band guys to play soccer in the parking lot, so we'd play soccer. You know, I made a point of getting rest. When the gig was over, I'd go sleep.
It's a good thing.
You take care of yourself. The food thing was the most complicated.
Challenge.
That was the challenge because, after the gig, you want to go in and just eat everything that's in the truck stop.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like 19-gallon glass
Taco
of milk,
Bell.
All the eggs and bacon you could eat.
Ooh, man, that's tasty.
Anything else?
Nah, that's good.
Oh, no, we got one thing else. Let me find it here. Spotify, Jess, is still going to start handling podcasts.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
Yes, they are. So the company, the service will allow, what's it say here, podcasters to easily link their RSS feeds to Spotify and allow for easy upload through various podcast aggregators. Boy, everybody's into it. Everybody is trying to get a piece of everything.
Yeah, well, actually, and on that note, I think, did I talk about it last week? I'm not sure, but Spotify is going to allow artists to upload their own songs directly.
And the artist.
Yeah. Bypassing going through an aggregate or distributor or whatever you need. So that's a cool feature. They're testing it out right now in the U.S., and we'll roll it out worldwide as it goes. But great idea, I mean, for you and I, because generally you have to go through a third party, and it takes time to get this way. You can just get it in there and go. Much to the chagrin of labels.
What do you got? You got some music?
Yeah,
what do you want to play?
This came out from last week's Burt Burns, and I finished the documentary.
Oh, you got a Burt Burns track.
Yeah. Well, it's not actually, but this is Irma Franklin. We were playing Irma last week. This is her version of Light My Fire. And Irma is, of course, Aretha's sister.
Play it.
Is she the older sister?
I don't know. No, I think that's Carolyn Franklin. Okay. You sure this is Aretha?
This is Irma Franklin.
Yeah, but I mean, is this Aretha's sister?
I'm going to check it out.
No, I think Carolyn Franklin's Aretha's.
We're going to look
there. Irma's New Orleans.
All right.
Check it out.
All right. Irma Franklin there.
Yes, and that is
Light My Fiber. That is
the older sister.
Older sister, yeah.
And Carolyn's the younger sister.
Yeah, and then there's Cecil, gotcha. The brother.
Jess, Burt Burns.
Boyd Boyns.
2 years ago, we recorded with, when we were doing these singles a month with the Rhythm Express, we would bring an artist in as part of the band. You know, we've had Julian
Taylor
and Amoy and all of everybody's done one or another. And then we got in Jonathan Knight, who has his own band, and we did this Burt Burns tune. We played this. This was Everton Paul, Shaky, and Chris Butcher.
Chris.
Yeah, Heavyweights Brass Band. And the whole crew, you're on bass, I'm on keys and everything. This is our version of Cry to Me, which is a great song.
Boyd Boyns.
Yeah, Boyd Boyns song.
Heard that since we did it.
No, Jonathan Knight on vocals. Boy, yeah, he sang it great.
Nice guitar playing, too. Yeah,
yeah, Shaky. I think the original version was Solomon Burke. I think he did it.
I think that sounds about right.
Yeah, it sounds great.
So I was just talking to somebody, and I'm not going to name names, and I was asking, so what are you going to be doing for the long weekend? Are you going up north? And
somebody asked you that?
No. So I was asking somebody.
Oh, what are people doing over the long weekend?
And so one person said they're going up north. And the big plan, the ambitiousness of this plan is mind-boggling. I'm going to roast a chicken and smoke a pack of cigarettes. And I said, that is about, I mean, if you can nail that, you can pretty much conquer all.
Yeah, man. They may want to borrow my medical marijuana card.
That was great.
And improve on the weekend.
But you know what? It's not every day you're going to do that.
No.
So this is the weekend to get out there and celebrate
and enjoy the weekend.
Eat some.
You know,
some
I was
chicken.
Thinking that we've got tonight, Saturday night and Sunday night. We got dinners. And hanging with friends and people. And I love doing that.
And Monday is going to be recuperation day.
That's a different day entirely. But, I love this time of year, you know. It's just that, I was out last night. And Slate Music had a showcase of their artists last night. Theo Tams and what's her name? It has the hits. Kayla Diamond. And their artists and everything. And it was just at the Phoenix. The Phoenix has been remodeled. It looks great.
Which is great, yeah.
Yeah, I remember going in. It used to be so stinky.
The black pit.
Oh man, even the restroom is great now. You know, yeah. The bathroom is great, but just being in there and everybody was so sociable and having fun. I guess it was kind of like the end of summer. You know, everybody's been away and sort of doing different things, and then they're all back saying, "Man, we're kind of back in our groove again that we know about." Because that's the one kind of one that carries you through now through November and then December, and then
that's it.
January. Everybody's like freeze-dried, you don't know where they go. What happens?
This is hibernation time. But it is. I love this time of year
as
well. You know, we got out for a walk. I think it was Sunday morning. It was the first one where you had a nice like sweatshirt on. You went and got a coffee, and you had just beautiful sunshine and kind of crisp morning.
It's a great place to be. You know, we were talking about it, me and Jessica earlier. You know, and I said, living in LA for a couple years. You know, there's no change of seasons. And
I think that would bother me.
And I would close my eyes and go, where's a maple tree at? Where's a place where a leaf actually hits the pavement?
Mm.
You know, the change, this whole thing. And you get
to miss
that.
Yeah. Four seasons, I'm all up for that. And I did want to say, Jessica was kind enough to deliver everybody a tasty cookie.
One of her cookies, yeah.
Man.
Chocolate chip. Yeah, she put some love on that cookie, didn't she?
She smothered the love on that cookie.
Smothered the love.
The cookie was smothered. I brought another track.
What do you got,
buddy?
Play.
And this is a band out of the UK, London, called Nubian Twist that I've known for years, but brand new from their album and the track called Workhorse. I think it fits well for what we're doing. So
you're listening to Bill and Jess King here on Groove Radio Fridays, right here all over the basin here, the southern basin of Ontario. You can hear us.
So kick me out, let the style put fever in the seas to this notion of green leaves and room for further doubt. Winning by landslide, don't need to abbreviate the score. Only generalize the faces falling through the door. Haven't worked in weeks in which I haven't got a clue. Brush me off your seat because your lunch is coming through. So say that, explain all your do's and your don'ts. Waste a spark and entrance, know the sucker's got your foes to the tonic notes. To my lonely life of three, a child you never wanted, but his money's majority. Can't speculate the needs of the industry's most wanted. These boys have got my back, and for that I'm truly honored. Ready to split, ready to die, ready to surpass. You know it don't mean shit till we got the finance to lean back. Listen to some older tape reels, something brothers can glue to through chrome and steel. Mercy in the workout's mold is to be denied, left and told. Mold is to be denied, left to toward. Mercy is the workhouse mold is to be denied, left and toward. Mercy is the workhouse mold is to be denied, left and toward. In my conquest overdue, through this sitting kind of sorrow avenue, crosses with different sands, reflects with prey, my souls to keep on this land. You ain't got no right to say I know ya. You ain't got no right to say I told you, son. All the time we're settling in.
Nice track, man.
Yeah. That's Nubia from Nubian Twist.
Really?
Yeah.
And what's the story behind that?
She is a singer from Leeds that moved in a few years ago with a good friend of mine, Grippa, who runs the Hempolics, been working with them. And what's interesting is all these guys that are part of the Hempolics all have other bands and different projects. So right. The other singer from the band has a band called The Drop, which I've, and I, it's funny because I've remixed yeah. all these guys and worked with them without knowing they were all part of the same band.
That's
so,
the way to do it. Yeah. Though,
very cool.
Jess, let's give some, let's give Sharon Jones some love here, okay?
I'd like to give some love. She's fantastic.
Yeah,
man.
This is a Kenny Dope remix from 2008. And it's called Keep On Working. And the tune, it's on a compilation called Soul Shaker Volume 5.
All right.
Sharon Jones.
That thing is just full of kicking punches.
Vim and vigor.
Man, I got a black eye from that snare.
So we're probably going to hang around here for a little while.
Just for a few minutes. The next show coming up is possibly in a traffic jam for the moment, but on his making his way back.
If you're in a car in Toronto, you're in a traffic jam.
You can't get on the 401 or any of these things. There's a crash every two blocks.
So we're waiting for his call?
Yeah, well, he's going to call in about 2 o'clock just to let everybody know, and then we're going to kick around until he's able to hop on the mic. But just in case he is there, we wanted to say goodbye.